Typhoon Nika is about to exit the Philippine area of responsibility, but here's the thing, another storm is threatening the country. Let's get more details. From ABS-CBN resident meteorologist Ariel Rojas, he joins us live. Ariel, over to you.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina. Actually, there are two other disturbances that will threaten the country within this week. The first one is severe tropical storm Nika about to leave the PAR this afternoon. It was last spotted more than 300 kilometers west of Calayan, Cagayan, still with strong winds of 95 kilometers per hour and gusts up to 115 kilometers per hour. Wind signal number one remains hoisted over northern Luzon or over Ilocos Norte, northern Apayao, northwestern Mindanao, Cagayan, and western Mabuyan Islands. These wind warnings will be lifted as the storm moves farther away from Luzon. Nika's trough may still bring some gustiness and scattered rains over the western sections of northern and central Luzon. Meanwhile, tropical storm Ophel intensified slightly while still far from land. It was last located 950 kilometers east of the Bicol region with sustained winds of 85 kilometers per hour and gusts up to 105 kilometers per hour. It is swiftly moving west-northwestward at 35 kilometers per hour. It is not yet affecting any part of the country. Wind signals for Ophel may be raised over parts of Cagayan Valley beginning tonight or early tomorrow, and it will continuously intensify up to typhoon strength while crossing the Philippine Sea, which will warrant the raising of signal number 4. Ophel may make landfall over Cagayan Valley on Thursday and bring with it intense rains, severe winds, and strong and possible storm surge. Meanwhile, the other disturbance still out of the PAR, tropical storm Manny, may enter the country's territory by Thursday or Friday and will be given the local name Pepito. The system may approach northern Luzon by weekend or early next week. Changes may still happen in the forecast, so we encourage the public to continue monitoring updates on these weather disturbances. That's the latest on the weather. This is Ariel Rojas. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Ariel Rojas, there joining us live. House lawmakers left with more questions as they scrutinize the budget spending of Vice President Sara Duterte's office. See, on Monday, the House Committee on Good Government cited four individuals linked to the OVP in contempt for repeatedly snubbing the probe. The panel's chairperson, Manila Representative Joel Chua, asserts the testimonies of the summit officials are crucial as they hold key information on the OVP's use of confidential funds.
In all the documents, like for example, the disbursement vouchers, the checks, the liquidations, in all these documents, their name appears. So especially the special disbursement officer, si Gina Acosta and Fajarda, Edward Fajarda, they were the one who withdrew the checks. One of the resource persons, si Attorney Sanchez, she mentioned na lahat sila, it seems that they are not very much familiar with the confidential fund. So when Congressman J.J. Suarez asked them why, according to Attorney Sanchez, it boils down to three persons. Number one, si Gina Acosta. And then si Attorney Zuleika Lopez. And then the Vice President herself. So they're the only one who are very familiar with the nitty-gritty details of the confidential fund.
The panel also looking into the purpose of the OVP satellite offices, which cost the agency over ₱1 billion to operate in just 1 year.
Dati kasi wala namang mga ganyang offices eh. Diba? That's why we're trying to find out kung talagang ito ay nagagamit sa tama. Apparently may 10 satellite offices at may isa pang extension office somewhere in Tondo. That is part of the reason kung bakit lumaki rin yung kanyang pondo. Ayan, may mga additional sila mga professional expenses. So may mga dagdag sila sa mga tao. Tsaka lahat lumubong because of this satellite offices. So ang mga tatanungin namin dapat dyan is sa susunod yung mga how much they're paying for the rentals.
More details emerge on the cabinet appointments of U.S. President-elect Donald Trump. Sources say Trump has selected Senator Marco Rubio as his Secretary of State. Rubio has advocated for years for a muscular foreign policy with respect to America's geopolitical foes like China, Iran, and Cuba. The appointment will make the Florida senator the first Latino to serve as America's top diplomat. Trump has also reportedly picked his national security advisor, Republican Representative Mike Waltz. Waltz will be responsible for briefing Trump on key security, make that key national security issues, and coordinating with different agencies. The Trump loyalist is known to have criticized Chinese activity in the Asia Pacific and has called on America to be ready for a potential conflict in the region. The incoming president has also revealed he had chosen Republican Representative Elise Stefanik to be U.S. ambassador to the United Nations. The U.N. has said it is ready to work with Trump's pick.
Member states will appoint, leaders of member states will appoint their representatives, and we will work constructively with the permanent representative of the United States, just like we do with every other country.